Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for having me here. And Ingmar, thanks for the introduction, the explanation, and also like the example that you gave. I would like to talk about creativity, but most of all, I would like to focus on entrepreneurship and what that means. And in my opinion, and that's like something that is very important, you don't have to share my opinion. You can agree to disagree always, but I would like you to make somehow to activate your thought process and also like the awareness of maybe like take a couple of things in and thinking about like afterwards, maybe just one activity that you can do straight away after the talk. Entrepreneurship, that's why I put like the acrobat here. I lived it through my life a couple of times. I started up, I have experience in different countries, but I think it's like an endless process. And it's someone by definition who actually is taking risk, which is right the opposite of what most people want to do, because they're afraid of taking risks. But the fact is, we're in the biggest transformation of the economy and society. In my opinion, after talking to so many people in so many different countries, working in the economy, in industries, but also like on social initiatives and as well in academia, I think this moment where we are in the history of human being is pretty unique. We need entrepreneurs, we need entrepreneurship, and we need creativity more than ever. Why? Because we need to question everything. We need to question our basic pillars of the economy. We need to rethink and transform how energy is working, how transportation is working, how political institutions are working, how education is working, and how can we do that? By using creativity. And we need entrepreneurs, and I hope you are on the way to do that if you're not already started. I talked to like two people about, specifically about creativity. One is like John Hopkins. He's the one, the author of Creative Economy. He's the one who developed the creative cluster for the city of London, understanding that in the 90s already that like creativity is quite important to position the city itself. And he just asked me, he said, hey, when we talk about like the economy and we talk about like creativity, what would be left if you would take out creativity out of like the economy? Probably nothing, it's impossible. And Richard Florida, who also works with Obama and is a director and a researcher on creativity and business at the Toronto School, Rockman School in Toronto, he always focus on that's the last resource that we have, the last untapped and infinite resources that we have. It's our human creativity. We need that. It is the backbone of our economy. There's no way around. But historically, we always relate that like to artistic creativity. And it's pretty similar because it's a search. It's like an endless process to find creative excellence. I don't know if you're familiar with Paco de Lucia. Paco de Lucia is like one of the persons who changed completely flamenco and how we see that. And it's probably not that to everyone used, but I think it's like a great example and would like to show you quick his video.
Mi nombre es uno de los grandes genios. Pienso en gente que trabaja y ha trabajado mucho y que tiene talento. Yo nunca planifico, improviso. Tenía como miedo de salirme de lo convencional, porque también con mi mundo. Y saliendo me daba terror.
Volví tan claro cuando me senté a lo de Paco y vi el camino que había por delante que no te daba miedo hacerlo, porque estabas con la seguridad de que aquello que estábamos haciendo estaba bien hecho.
Extendió los límites o las fronteras del flamenco, ¿no? En todo sentido, hasta en lo social.
You can't contain Paco inside flamenco music. Paco is too big for that.
The music that he plays, the notes that he selects are free from this. It's outside of time.
No podía imaginar ni a soñar que me echara donde yo iba a llegar con la guitarra.
movie, La Búsqueda, The Search Of, and I really recommend you to see this movie if you have like the possibility. Because what he's talking about is, I hope you saw like the subtitle, it's not about genius, that's not the idea. You don't have to be like in a perfect state, you don't have to have like all these contacts, you don't have to have like that much money. He actually just started off with a guitar, but he had like a vision behind it. And he said, okay, something needs to be changed. That's not all what you've learned in music and flamenco until this moment. And he convinced them. And I think one of the things that we as entrepreneurs sometimes have like problems with is to transmit security when things are unstable. But we need to show to our employees, we need to show like to our social peers that everything is going right. But we need to have this inner need to somehow develop something new. And that's a huge challenge for all of us. The biggest challenge with creativity is to make tangible what's in your head. And I'm pretty sure if I would ask you, write down like your bucket list, the things that you would love to do, the things that you're dreaming of, the things that you like somehow sometimes have on your mind, but you never find time. That's the difficulty of it. What's in your head, how can you transmit that? That's why it is, in the end, it's a process of learning. And I would like to focus, when we talk about like organization, when we talk about like an individual level, when we talk about like creativity and how we apply that, it is a journey. It's a process of learning. It's not yet, if you want to know how it will end, it's probably, you're gonna limit yourself. See it as what we call like a serendipity. It's a journey. You start somewhere, and then you develop it. That is like the way to do it. That's like also the way to see it. But it clashes very much with our traditional way of thinking. We have, and we since like actually Aristoteles, Plato and Socrates, 3,500 years ago, we always think about and trying to find like the truth. Most educational systems are built on that, on critical thinking. That's right, that works pretty well and it's very important. But the new dimension, and this is like what design schools bring in, and a lot of other new universities, and that's creative thinking. That is about accepting the impossible. That's the new thing. And this is like something that springs out of your curiosity, a very natural way. But most of the time, you know that, you have meetings, you present something, there's always a danger that like someone is criticizing that. That someone wants to try like the truth. Is it really true what you're saying? It's not about that. It's about like building up on things. It's like having ideas and putting that in a room and let the room work for itself. And that's like something that is very difficult in traditional ways. I started at a design school like 27 years ago in an art academy. That was like one way of thinking. Afterwards, when I did like the MBA, that is like the typical critical thinking way of doing. You're gonna go there and they're gonna ask straight away, like, is this true what you're saying? What we need to do is like to combine that. But it's not an easy one. Why? Because we are trained. We are actually, as Edward de Bono, the one who has like the six thinking heads and lateral thinking defined, and probably like one of the most creative persons on this planet, said, it's typical. There are like three stages in life. The first one starts off between like 0 and 5. We always ask why. Why can a plane fly? Why is like the things are like they are? And afterwards, between like 5 and 11, there's the next day. Why not? Why can't I fly? Why can't I try to do something? And since that point, you're gonna find out until the rest of your life, that always, when you have an idea, when you have like a new plan, when you have like a new model, when you have a new service, when you have like anything that you want to launch, someone is telling you, you can't do that because of. That's our limitation. This is like the way how our limitation works in daily life. And that's sometimes really frustrating. But as modern entrepreneurs, we don't need to switch from critical thinking to creative thinking. What I found out most of the time I saw is we need like a hybrid mindset. We need to combine those things. It's not one or the other, it's like the combination of it. It's like the fusion of it. That's the beauty of it. And you see, for example, just one question. How can we change education? Is education the way how we're gonna teach? And you talked about it as well. is it like the way how it should be, in my opinion? And this is what I try like since the last decade, to be much more involved in education. I was the academic dean of one of the biggest design universities in Europe, in the site in Barcelona. I'm visiting a professor at Hyper Island in Stockholm, where I just came like the last 3 days, and in Lucerne in Switzerland. It's a new way and a new form of educating people, but it's not enough. We need more. We need to rethink the whole educational system. Question, how can we do that? What do we need to do? How can it be that we are like in a room and we have like a board and it's limited? It limits our thoughts. When we write on a whiteboard, it's not that we have enough space. No, it's limited. Everything is always limited. We have like a little black book where we write in. Even today, it's well done, the folder, but it gives us a limitation, constraints. Open up, let's try to somehow go further. That's the idea. And try to combine knowledge and imagination. And we need to be trained on that. How should social entrepreneurship work in the future? What's the idea about it? How could it look like? It's a question that we ask. With a traditional way of thinking, we probably will not find the answer. And logic and magic, that combination, this is on an individual level, but also like on an organizational level, the way how we should work. And just believe me, I know that like the emotions shouldn't like affect us, but most things are like, really driven by emotions. And the beautiful thing is, for example, I don't know how many times you fall in love in your life, but that's like the moment when like emotion really takes over, and it's very beautiful as well. So we shouldn't completely ignore that. But what we should do, whenever we work on and apply creativity in our context, we should be aware of the consequences as well. And not just do like creativity for the sake of creativity. One of the persons I talked to in Milan, in Italy, is like the founder of Domus Academy, one of the, after the education of architects, they found out that they need to have like a new system in the 60s. And she's one of the old grand ladies of Italian design. And she always said, it is very, very important before you pick up your, at that time, like a pencil, now this would be like the laptop or the iPad, to open your mind and ask yourself what the true needs are of the society we are working for. And that's the key thing. Does it serve us as human beings? Last year I went with an organization called like CCL, Center for Creative Leadership, to Ethiopia. They work there on female leadership, they work on different organizations, and we're like a team of psychologists, sociologists, and me as a design thinker, and we talked to like a couple of engineers. And the interesting thing was when they said, yeah, one of the cases that we would like to share, and I would like to tell you about as well, is that we always have this default way of thinking. That means we come up with solutions that worked in the past, and we think they're going to work in this situation as well. They talked about like a couple of Western European engineers. They came to Africa, and they saw that they observed, they had like an insight, because it's a part of the design thinking process, and said, yeah, they observed that like young people, they had to walk a long distance every single day to get like the water and come back. And said, hey, but we are Europeans, we are smarter. We know exactly what we need. The solution would be, let's put like a pipeline there, so we get the water from the source, and they don't have to walk every single day that long distance. They did it, and everyone was happy. Thanks God they did like a follow-up, which is, by the way, like also one of the biggest things in creativity. And they found out like 5 years later that the birth rate dropped down to almost zero. And they asked why. Until they found out that the traditional way of walking and sending like young women, young men to that source, everything similar to spring to get like the water, their path is cross. And this is like how they get to know each other. The rest is up to your imagination, how like the population evolved traditionally. By putting a pipeline, they destroyed everything that was like done over the last probably like 1 or 2,000 years. So be aware as well of like the consequences when you apply creativity. And context. If If you need to write down something, then it's like probably like context is very important when you apply creativity. And what we do normally is we just take over like benchmarks, references, other examples, and we think they work for us as well. But it's not. And that's why I think like awareness is so important. You need to be aware of like the context. If you don't get like the context, you apply creativity in the wrong way. And then it's like a PDM. We need to reframe actually like our ideas of work. And the way how to make tangible like creativity is by a project. And as I mentioned before, that's the difficult thing. But everything in organization as well is changing. The vertical structures of organizations is now much more horizontal. That means also like to lead teams, creative teams, to work with people on creativity has completely evolved in a different way. What we need there is like an interdisciplinary approach. But traditionally, we always try to find like the same people and bring that in. But we need to cross them. And that's why like that's the beauty also like of such a conference. You're going to find today so many different opinions and statements and experiences. But that's beautiful, because that helps us. And they're like the things that are springing out. And if you work in business, there are like two things, traditionally as well. I don't know how many MBAs we have here, how many like people are trained on business school, but normally if they find like a system, they explore like the system until the last moment. The interesting part is, nowadays when we see that like most industries are somehow breaking down because they're much more fragmented, and they know that like the system itself doesn't work, they have like difficulties to somehow start off like an innovation process. Because the people in the system do have this critical thinking approach to it and are not yet capable to really build like the base and space to somehow let creativity grow there. To think about what might and could be is a different thing. And tradition is also like, it's not appreciated by organizations. Most organizations are like, if you have an idea and you want to change like the business model, they're like, oops. Change processes normally work when things are going wrong, which is a pity. Normally we should have that like at least like a 60-40%. That means like of course you need to make sure that your existing business model works, but invest a lot in exploration. And at the moment, in this decade and the next one, where the transformation of the economy is so strong, that's a perfect place and a perfect situation to do that. And the problems that we have. Let's talk about education. How could like education look like? There is no right answer. It's impossible. We need to have like multiple answers. And probably like it's a fusion of it. It's testing, it's trying. How can it be that like when I am in a classroom, we have like still tables and chairs. Something that separates us between like the people that they are here. And someone comes in and wants to be like an expert. How can you be like an expert nowadays? We all have like the information to it. We should be like facilitators. But it's the problem. It would be much easier to have like just one answer and that's it, but it's not true. How can we somehow solve immigration? That's a huge topic in most of the world. It's a tremendous problem in Southern Europe. How can we solve unemployment? We have like an unemployment rate in Spain of like 26%. Do you know what it means? We have an unemployment rate in the age group to 24 of more than 50%. How can we solve that? Very difficult. We need creativity to do that. We need to have like a couple of answers. There's no right answer. But most politicians, they try to say, okay, this is like the plan, this is like the 12-step plan, and this is like the solution for it. It doesn't work. We need to change the system. But probably we need to change like the people and how they got educated to get there to somehow solve this. And that's the huge challenge. In my opinion, as I mentioned before, you don't have to share that, but I think that like not more than 1% of all ideas are really implemented. And there are two reasons for it. 48% is like just because of procrastination. We have an idea, but we don't do it. We wait. Yeah, tomorrow, or next week, or next month. No, I'm busy. I don't have like the time for it. Very dangerous. And sometimes a shame. And most of the time then these are like the people who say, yeah, I also had like the idea of Facebook. Yeah, but you didn't do that. I had also like the idea to put like a battery as like the Tesla model in a car and just revolutionize like the and start off like really attacking the automotive market, which I think is tremendously awesome. And now he starts off like putting batteries as a possibility for the end consumer to somehow be independent to like the energy companies. And interesting enough, I'm working like, for the energy company of the city of Zurich in Switzerland. But and we're working on innovation, but it's like such a radical approach to it that it's not easy to implement. Yeah? And sometimes you need to be free of like the old system to do that, which is a pity. I think that the fusion of it should be. But if you have an idea, don't procrastinate always. It's really a shame because I meet so many people and they have such beautiful ideas. And that's why when Ellen and me contacted me and said, hey, we have this idea, we would love to do like this conference. And I didn't doubt about that. I said, yes, of course, because that's the beauty of it. Support those ideas. And I am sure in 3, 4, 5 years time, we see something that has a new form, and that's a process. We don't know what it is, but it's already on the way, and it's a cool thing. And the second one is like the most dangerous one. That's like other people's boycott. This is like the resistance to new ideas. And that's like more than 50% of all people. And it doesn't come from the outside, because traditionally, entrepreneurs always say, yeah, like that's not the right market condition, we don't have like the money, we don't have like enough good people. Well, true, but sometimes it's like in the organization itself that the resistance comes from. My experience, for example, like in education, the biggest resistance in education was not from the student side. They love it. Hey, I'm a facilitator. Get up, stand in the room, don't sit. You think much better when you stand up. It's a physical activity. It's not like people hate studying, but they love learning. They loved it. The parents, when you explain that and see that like their kids start off like doing much more and they're much more productive, they love it as well. But a traditional teacher, the one who was like used to come into the classroom and be like the one in charge, the one who says, okay, you need to do this, you need to do that, work on that because it's like you have your weaknesses there. They were like the ones, and they're like still the ones, who do have like problems to change that. I understand that because it like it takes a lot of authority from them, but they also miss a really, really amazing opportunity to be part of that process. And that's why I think like just 1% of all good ideas are really like changing. It's a pity, but keep that in mind. It's not the market. It's not outside. It's most of the time inside that there is like resistance. In Stanford, over the last 20, 30 years, Professor Carol Dweck, she studied like those mindsets, and she came up like with two. It's like, of course, a stereotype, but it helps a lot. And it's about like the fixed and the growth mindset. Resistance comes normally from a fixed mindset. What does it mean? That means like there's a fear of failure. We try to avoid risk, and we are like easily discouraged. You wake up sometimes in the morning, you have like an idea, you meet someone, you talk about it there, and say, I'm not sure about that, and you forget about that idea. That's a fixed mindset. In an organization, when you have like silos, and you start off like an innovation and sustainability process on a strategy to develop like new business model that could somehow take over like the existing one, you're gonna have loads of fixed mindsets there. What you need is a growth mindset. That means like failure is actually like a part of it. Teamwork is more important than the individual effort. And you should also like reward creative effort and not the one who seems to be the smartest in the room, because that guy is in the wrong room. Use and understand that the room is like the smartest person. An example of a growth mindset, I don't know if you heard about him, it's like Helena Lass. He was recognized for a couple of years as the most creative chef on this planet. He had a different approach to the restaurants, the kitchens. It was out of a need that he couldn't afford to run his business like the whole year at the Costa Brava close to Barcelona. And then he decided, okay, I can just open in 6 months, but I will not wait over the winter and do anything just to wait until I can go back and cook and serve my clients. He started off like a laboratory, and he started off traveling. And he started off every single year, he got like six, with his team, 6,000 recipes. And over the 6 months in the laboratory, he broke it down to one menu. And believe me, that made him really good. He had no idea what comes out in the end. He had no idea, he could never ever say what's the next season's menu. But well, something I think went pretty well. Because like the way how he did it, now it's closed. 2 years ago they closed it, there was like a personal decision. They said, okay, we reached that stage. There is at the moment for us no more. And we would like to do and enter like different other industries. So get out of like their own industry to enter like a new industry. Also like a thought that I think like for a chef is not like the usual way of thinking. But this process made him super interesting as I would say he's like one of the person who helped also, like if you see nowadays restaurants, the kitchen is open, you can see like the cook, it has like a different presence. And all these new food types that we see, that's a consequence of it, like to really evolve the industry. So return on investment is one thing, but the stronger part is like really like the return on creativity. It should be like a ratio in business planning. The part that you use to really foster creativity, the base for it. And you as entrepreneurs, you have like the unique opportunity because you can select people. You don't have to work with the old system. That's the beauty of it. That's probably like also like in most of the cases, like your motivation to do something different. So establish like a new organization. Don't copy like the old one where you're from. Do a new one. That's a unique chance. Not an easy one, but Friedrich Kabler, a book that I also strongly recommend, it's called like The Hidden Connections, he talks about it. And the culture that you have in your organization is very important. I think this is like something that we should be aware of it. The culture of a company gets more and more important. He talks about like changing culture and increasing productivity do not come from labor, but from the capacity to equip labor with new capabilities based on new knowledge. This here today should be transmitted like to the whole country, should be transmitted like to the whole, to all companies, because we need that in companies. We need that new insights. We need now these new inputs that help us like to really develop something new. And how do we unclog this fixation that we sometimes meet? Because we default to what worked in the past and prior experience that bind us to the new experiences. Fixation, that's a huge topic on an individual level, but also like on an organization level, as well as on a political level. That really can stop the creative process cold. To overcome that, that's a study that comes from Cambridge, recommends to, and it's very practical, create cultural diversity in your teams. Get people from the outside in. Yes, they think different, and sometimes you're not agreeing, but as I mentioned before, agree to disagree, but it makes you smarter, and makes like the organization smarter, and evolves in a different way that you probably didn't expect, but it helps you. Get interdisciplinary teams. In most jobs, it's quite interesting that like people try to tend like to the same education and the same types. Like human resource people love to talk to human resource people. Engineers love to talk to engineers. Find a fusion and get creative people in. Get new thoughts. Get a product designer in. Get an innovation expert in. Get these people in because that helps you like to really enrich your process. And have facilitators and not project managers. Someone who has like, the capacity on an emotional level and the empathy and sensitivity to really bring human peoples together and to make that constructive. It's much more like a trajectory thinking. It's not where you are, but you know somehow that you want to leave that place and you want to go somewhere different and take what you have. That's a picture that I took last year in Ethiopia, and I found it impressive. They just take what they have, yeah, and they do it, and that's the tremendous thing. I went to Japan to talk to Tokushin Yoshioka, who was like an assistant to Issei Miyake. Some of you maybe like know like him. He's designing emotions. He always tried to somehow work with stuff that like no one has seen before. And this is like a stand and in a fair in Milan, the sign fair in Milan, probably like the most recognized worldwide. His basic concept was like snowflakes, and make that big, and show like the beauty of it, and work on like the essence of something, and try to transmit that. Very beautiful. But keep and take care of one thing. When passion gets into the way of your personality, it can sometimes be a bit tricky. Why is that? Creative people and passionate people, people who are working really a lot. And it's good that you are like on continuous improvement and you try to optimize what you're doing. There's also like a risk of burnout. Interesting enough, something that I learned in Japan, when you work more than like 60 hours constantly per week, you know that you have like a risk of burnout. That's like one thing, but Japan has a word for it. It's kawashi, it's death by overwork. Be aware that it's nice that your passion goes into production, but it needs to be balanced. And I know lots of people and also entrepreneurs, because I coach them, and it's sometimes really difficult, because the responsibility that they take over is pretty big. And one of the key secrets that we should learn is like, how can we balance that? And probably what we're gonna listen to today are gonna be like lots of things that help us on that way. That's at the entrance of the music faculty at the University of Westminster. How to feel miserable as an artist. Just replace artist by entrepreneur. How to feel miserable as an entrepreneur. And just read like the first one. Constantly compare yourself to other entrepreneurs. That stresses you. Yeah? Do your own stuff. Don't do like benchmarks all the time. Yeah? Don't talk to like your family, friends, and expect them to cheer you. That's also sometimes when you have like something new in your head. Yeah? Imagine like the day when they started off like with Tesla. Imagine when they started off like with PayPal, all these systems that like Skype. We have Spotify, we have like enough examples. Yeah? There was like something new, and definitely like loads of people said, yeah, don't do that. Actually, when I started off writing my book, most people told me, you're so busy, on top you want to do this, why do you do that? It doesn't make sense. Hey, that's why I'm here today. And it's a justification for everything. It's so rewarding to share thoughts with you, to be like part of this team, to see afterwards like all the other speakers. And I couldn't plan that before. So don't get discouraged. Another recommendation, find people who care. The biggest and most decisive thing that you can do in your career is select the right people. Look people in the eyes. When you don't trust them, run away. And when you are getting better on selecting your environment, your surrounding, you will have much more success, however you define success. People are decisive, but the wrong people are very dangerous. Create, that was like one thing. The second one, very practical. How can you create a learning environment? When you start off, when you have like an organization, it doesn't matter if it's 5 people, 10 people, 20, 50, or 2,000. Create a learning environment. It's about learning. An organization is about learning, nothing else. failure is part of that. How can you do that? How does it look like? Most people would like to love to go to work, but they don't do. One of the first indicators of my personal research study was like that, and it was like 10 years ago in the Financial Times. Only 9% of all European workers do have a job that is in line with the personality structure. And they don't like, actually, like we should rebrand the word work because it's negative. And most of the time we talk about, hey, I need to go to work, and it's like, how can you create this space that people feel comfortable there and constructive? And we have things that their ideas are going to get rewarded, that they can express and visualize their ideas. And I'm not talking about that you should do it like Google on all these examples. Find your own way. Don't go out and try to find like other things. Yeah? Go back like how like an artist is working. Yeah? He has like everything there. And it's learning by doing. Yeah? It's not out of books. It's learning by doing. Feedback makes champions. In leadership training, we always talk about like SBI, situation, behavior, impact. It's not about like, I like this, I like that. It's not about like, I like blue, I like green. It's about, this is a situation, this is like your behavior, and this is like the impact of it. People need and love feedback. They need that. It's like the self-awareness and the awareness and the perception from the outside differs always. Help them to grow. Again, that's like the growth mindset. Most people don't want, in teams and organizations, most people, they don't want that their team members gonna really grow. But that's the beauty of, for me personally, I mean, this is like why I'm on a big time in education as well. It's the beauty to see people like 5, 7, 10 years later. It would be beautiful to see you in 5 years' time and you say, based on this conference, I had like one idea, I implemented it, and now I have like my own business, I have like my own team, and I develop like a new service, a new product, or a new organization that I really had in my mind, and I really made it. That would be like the lovely thing. But feedback is important. That gives us like the possibility to grow. Write down like a manifesto, and it doesn't have to be like the typical vision, mission statement that is so nice in all organizations. Because take care, when you want to incorporate like the millennials in your organization, make sure that you walk your talk, because otherwise it will not work. El Bulli, a restaurant that I talked about, they now like the foundation, they put it here on a piece of paper. No shuttles, no bookings, no routine, no security, and yes, there is risk, yes, there is freedom, and yes, there is creative freedom. Very simple, it's at the door and everyone sees it. And the most important thing is like, they really do it like this. I want to show you, because like the millennials are really like a very important part. I don't know if you've heard about like this cool Hyper Island in Stockholm. For me, it's like one of these examples in education that is specifically like focusing, of course, of the digital industry. But these are like people around like 20, 30, very smart. They learn that the process is really the most important thing. They also learn that you should trust the room and the people inside. They understand that the organization is going to be horizontal and not vertical anymore. But if you don't give them a purpose, they will not come to your organization. That's the first generation that we have, nothing related to the baby boomers, generation X or generation Y. If you don't give them like the base that they somehow feel identified, they will not come to your organization, they will not even buy your product. And that's going to be like for big corporations, the biggest problem in the next 2 decades. And on top, you have like the social demographics changing. That means more older people, less younger people. And the older people are like then going out of their jobs and retire. There we have a huge problem. To give you like a feeling how it could be, I would like to show you like one quick example.
Somebody who wakes up and goes to bed, and in between he does what he wants to do. think we see the city really different and discover it different, because I see normal people walking around the city and they're just walking like this with their heads down or on their mobile phone and just aren't really interested in what goes on around them. You walk around like looking around, seeing jumps everywhere, looking and
it's like breakdancing. You put a breakdancer in a room by himself and say go, it won't work. But if you get a crew and say go, and they're all, it works.
You know, there's things that are completely within my limits that I'm scared to do, but you know, overcoming that fear and letting your body do what it can do, and I just think it's so freeing to be able to do that.
Entrepreneurship. It's like taking what you have, having a stable relationship with yourself, believing like in your ideas, and really be convinced about that. This is what I see, and it's like a dream world, for sure, but that should be the vision of any organization. That should be like the organization that you somehow plan and really organize. For me personally, like in how I work every single day, I have one statement that is very important to me. I try to somehow live that with the vision to be like every single day a little bit better, and with the idea to building bridges between people. I strongly believe in cultural diversity. I think this is like, I believe also like in cultural diverse societies. I think that's the answer. And not the reason for our problems, which is depending on where I speak, on where I am, and where I work, can be sometimes difficult. But I'm really completely convinced, as an entrepreneur, you need to navigate this cultural diversity, you need to navigate complexity, and you need to navigate creativity. That's a big thing to do, but it's beautiful. It's a dream. You need to be aware, you need to evolve, you need to have a growth mindset. And I always go back to this quote. It's actually like the founder of Visa Card. I was surprised when I found it out, but the quote is tremendously, it's without integration, motivation is dangerous. Without motivation, capacity is impotent. Without capacity, your understanding is limited. Without understanding, knowledge is meaningless. Without knowledge, your experience is blind. I wish you the very best. And I ask you just for one thing, because you have like a folder and a piece of paper and a pen in your hand. Take 1 minute and write one thing down that you want to do in the next week. That is related to entrepreneurship, that is related to awareness, that is related to all these creative things that you have in your mind and you normally procrastinate to somewhere in the future. Do it now for 1 second. And don't think too much about it. Just let it flow. You as well. remember this moment, this decade, the next 2 decades actually, it's going to be like the biggest transformation. We need to rethink everything. We need to rethink energy, we need to rethink the political situation, we need to rethink capitalism, we need to rethink democracy, we need to rethink education. There's so many opportunities. Opportunities favors the prepared mind. Prepare yourself and take it as an amazing learning experience. That's why I call it like serendipity. Probably you don't know where you end up, but this process is beautiful. Thank you very much for your attention and enjoy